to cell communication and especially hormones. So recall that earlier in the year we talked about positive and negative feedback, so we're coming back to it here with some specific examples. You want to follow along in your notes. So on page 14 you have some additional examples of positive and negative feedback. And I'd also like you to add a little bit more to your notes there from my definitions. So first we're going to start off with positive feedback. And so one of the things to remember about this is that more gets you more. So when there's a particular stimulus, instead of responding by trying to dampen the stimulus, what will happen is we'll actually increase the effects of that stimulus. So the example that I have here is with an infant suckling to receive milk from its mother. So the stimulus in this case is picked up by the neurons first, sensing the suckling occurring, but then we have hormones that are released into the blood. The hormone is oxytocin in this case, and what that does is that causes the ultimate response of milk release. So in this case, it's positive feedback because more suckling is going to result in more milk being released, and this is positive feedback. The other couple examples that you have in your notebook, one is with childbirth. Once those hormones are released, which cause contractions to increase, you're going to continue to have more contractions until we complete or drive a process to completion. And then a non-human example I have are with fruit ripening. So you may have heard of this before. When you put a piece of ripe fruit in a bowl with unripe fruit, then it causes those other fruits to ripen faster because of that release of those hormones. So that's positive feedback. Negative feedback, remember, this is thinking more gets you less. So in this case here, we're trying to help maintain a set point. We're maintaining homeostasis. So the stimulus is actually going to cause a response that is going to get you back to maintaining a certain set point. So the example that I have here is with your small intestine. And so what happens here is if you have a really low pH that's received, or that signal of the low pH is received by the body in your duodenum, which is part of your small intestine, what's going to happen, they're going to release hormones. This hormone happens to be secretin, and that causes a buffer to be released. So bicarbonate is going to be released, and that's going to help to raise that pH back up. So we have a certain pH that needs to be maintained within the small intestine, and so because we've deviated from that, the body's going to respond to do what it has to do to get that pH back up to where it needs to be. So again, negative feedback is all about maintaining homeostasis, and you have two feedback loops for that in your packet. One is looking at blood calcium levels, so that's looking at two of the hormones, calcitonin and parathormone, and what those do is they work in opposite to help maintain blood calcium levels. And then the other example is maintaining your blood sugar levels. So insulin and glucagon work in opposite of each other to do that. So you should take some time to look at those examples that I have in your packet there and make sure you understand why they're examples of positive or negative feedback. And then finally, you're going to complete the summarizer box at the end of your notes when you're finished.